All right, welcome to Useful Idiots. I'm Matt Taibbi.
And I'm Katie Halper.
And Katie, you probably don't know this. This is my favorite day of the year.
Why? What is today?
I actually eagerly await this day every year, although it usually comes at a different time of the year. Today's the NBA draft.
Oh, right. I mean, that was too obvious. The way you said that made it sound like it wasn't also my favorite day. So that's why I was...
Right. That threw you off a little bit.
Yeah, threw me off. Yeah, right.
This, among other things, it's one of my favorite sort of media phenomena is watching the NBA because it has like one of the most predictable things that happens in media. Dan, if we could just see the first example I put in there. So this is the coach basically saying he's really happy that they got the guy that they got. And so they'll say things like, we didn't know he was going to be there at 15. That's the quote that you will see like eight of tomorrow.
Yeah.
Like we really didn't expect him to be there at 45. So here's like another example. This was a couple of years ago with a guy named Melvin Frazier who turned out not to like play at all. But this is the Orlando Magic saying, we had Melvin rated much higher than 35. We just didn't expect him to be there at 35.
Right. Like, it's like weird that he'd be still wouldn't have been scooped up, right?
He's scooped up. Yeah, oh my God, our good fortune. We got this guy and you, the fan, are so lucky because we lucked into this guy who shouldn't have fallen to us.
Are they ever right?
Occasionally. But most of the time it's just like, we're selling you on something that just happened randomly, but we want to make it out like it's a really awesome thing. So I look forward to that. Tonight, I'm going to guess that five people do that tonight.
Okay, cool.
We'll see if it turns out to be more than that. Yeah. Anyway, we have an amazing guest this week.
I've been thinking for a while, I wish he were here. Now he's going to be here.
Well, we better run like hell to get to the segment.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. We could go on and on like this.
I can barely feel my extremities. It's like I'm numb, but I'm not uncomfortable. I'm like comfortably numb. You know,
comfortably numb. Exactly.
Yeah. With anticipation. Yeah.
Well, not now, Katie. We've got to get on with the show.
All right. You know what I like doing? I like watching NBA with the sound off, listening to Pink Floyd.
That's a comeback. It's all come full circle now. So, all right, four food groups. Republicans suck. Democrats suck. Isn't that terrible? Isn't that weird? So Democrats suck. We do have a good one. Dan, if we could see the National Review story. Look, we're quoting the National Review. This is Democrats suck. What do you want us to do? Headline here is Biden appoints free speech antagonist to sell free speech abroad. And it's Rick Stengel, formerly the managing editor of Time. Charming picture of him. Biden has appointed him to the transition team for the U.S. Agency for Global Media, which I'd never heard of, by the way.
Is it new? Is this a post-disinformation thing?
It's ominous sounding, but according to the National Review, it's a public service media network that it oversees public service media networks that provide unbiased news and information in countries where the press is restricted. I have no idea what that means. So Stengel is basically one of these guys who's been at the forefront of this new sort of content moderation movement. There's a quote here where he, this is funny, from an op-ed he wrote in 2019. As a government official traveling around the world championing the virtues of free speech, I came to see how our First Amendment standard is an outlier. Even the most sophisticated Arab diplomats that I dealt with did not understand why the First Amendment allows someone to burn a Quran. Why, they asked me, would you ever want to protect that? So
that is like a good move. You know what he's doing there?
What is he doing?
Well, I mean, that's just a great like weaponizing wokeness, which is going to be a theme. I mean, it's been a theme, but
of course.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why would we want to protect Islamophobia?
Right. Yes. And you know, this is like that whole je ne suis Charlie Hebdo.
Right.
You know, or je ne suis pas Charlie, right? There's really not a lot to say about this, except this was my number one concern heading into this Biden presidency, was that these people do not believe in free speech and civil liberties. And moreover, that the big lesson that they took away from 2016 and the Trump presidency is that they just allowed too many people to say stuff.
Right.
And they're now going to fix that. So great. We're appointing a guy who believes that the First Amendment is an outlier. Incidentally, it's an outlier because we made it an outlier. Like that was right. The whole point of the United States right. was that we were going to be the only country that made this a priority.
Right.
We pretty much always have. We've kind of let the world down in other areas.
We've let the world down in this area too, but ostensibly in theory, right?
At home, we've never had in peacetime anyway, a formal media regulator.
But we did have, I mean, you know this better than anyone else, right? But we had the like Assange stuff, obviously.
Of course.
And then
yes.
the what was that foreign media, the FARA stuff?
Oh, you mean with the RT and making the, yes, we're using FARA to go after foreign media outlets. Yeah, all that stuff's kind of new. You know, for the most part, we've had a pretty free media up until
right
recently. So that freaks me out. For that to be one of the first stories that came out, that worried me. As you pointed out, there's another story that's kind of related.
Relieved that's not. We should keep a tab, like tally it: Russiagate or woke. Like what reason they give for doing something?
Oh right, sometimes it's both.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
In this case, it's both.
Yeah.
Right. We can't have the Quran burning, and we can't allow, you know, the Russians to interfere
right.
With the Quran burning. I think the other story that we can see it just quickly is it's an appointment of some oil and gas folks to a prominent position. This is from a friend of show, David Sirota. So Biden is appointing Cedric Richmond, the congressperson from Louisiana, to the Office of Public Engagement, where he's expected to liaise with the business community and climate change activists. Of course, he's an oil and gas person.
Right.
So he's going to be the person saying, yes, Ari.
Yes. And it's funny because, Matt, before we taped, I mentioned something about how annoying this was going to be because I knew that they were going to try to hide behind his being Black to justify whatever bad stuff he does. We saw a preview of this in an article where... So the story was that Sunrise Movement and Justice Dems wanted Biden to sign a pledge that he wouldn't name any lobbyists, corporate lobbyists or Wall Street people to his cabinet. And Gregory Meeks, said that was terrible. How could you do that? Because that would be at odds with diversity. Because,
yeah.
You know, the truth is that there are only the only people of color who are at all qualified to be on and serving in a cabinet are corporate shills. They don't have
right.
any, you know, there are no principled people of color to choose from.
I'm pretty sure their entire list of potentially diverse hires is just Deval Patrick.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Deval Patrick or this guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So in every conversation, they're saying, well, who do you think we could put in that? How about Deval Patrick?
Right.
Or Cedric,
yeah, right. Yeah. Or do you not want any, or it's okay, we don't have to put them on, we just won't have any people of color. That's fine. That's
right.
fine.
Yeah.
It's up to you.
I
mean, and it's so funny because they try to frame this as purity politics. And of course, like, well, if this is purity politics, so is diversity. Because why are we, they're both important though. And it's a false dichotomy. It's not mutually exclusive. It's not like a zero sum game.
I think there should be some kind of like an equation that tells you like how much of a bought off asshole you have
right.
to be in a major corporation to offset your contribution on the diversity front. So if you're a Black lesbian, but you hire death squads for BP or something like that, does that bring you back to even? Like what?
Right. I see what you mean. Yeah, exactly.
You know
we need to
there
make
has
a
to
chart.
Be an algorithm.
Yeah. Right. We need an algorithm. Yeah. In fact, maybe since we don't care about free speech that much, that guy, Stengler, he can
Spanky.
Like,
let's just call him Spanky.
Spanky. Yeah. Maybe yeah. Spanky can take care of that. He can
That's
make
right.
a, what would that be? A bought off. He'll just make an algorithm.
An algorithm.
And then, of course, he won't care because he doesn't.
He'll suppress it.
they'll suppress it, right? We won't know what's happening. And then basically we will get the most diverse cabinet of death squad coordinators that we've seen ever. And it's going to be amazing. You know, Michelle Fiorni, you know, who the Pentagon pick.
Oh, right. Yes.
Who brought us, who brought you great, whose greatest hits include Libya. She's going to break that glass ceiling. Mm-hmm. Really excited. You know, a lot of glass ceilings, I got to hand it to her. She's broken a lot of glass ceilings already, but usually in other people's countries without their consent.
Right.
Through bombing.
Usually with the heads of terror suspects.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We can do it. Equality. Slay queen, literal slay queen. I am woman. Hear me roar. Oh, and just really, I got to add this, that exactly like clockwork, Jonathan Martin from the New York Times tweets, because Sunrise Movement tweeted out that they were upset about this appointee. They tweeted, Cedric Richmond hire is betrayal due to big oil ties and silence and pollution in his district, right? Jonathan Martin writes, 21 preview, picking a fight right from the start with the most influential Black staffer in the White House who represented awesome. An energy-heavy district. And then he quotes Sunrise Movement saying that. So it's Biden and it's the media, like New York Times, making the point that how dare you? How dare you from the get-go look at someone's policy? You are a climate change organization, and how dare you question who Biden is naming?
Yeah.
So for Republican Suck, we got, dear friend of the show, dear friend of Matt Taibbi's, Max Boot, Max Das Boot. And he, as is his wont, he really likes to claim credit for no longer being a Republican. Speaking of death squads, I really like these people who are so loyal that they're okay with the Iran-Contra stuff. They're okay with Panama. They're okay with the Iraq war. But something, you know, once you get that Cheeto Mussolini into the White House, you just realize your values. No, they didn't. Their values didn't change. It's not that they left the Republican Party, right? The Republican Party left them.
Naturally.
But I don't really, it's like, I would say congratulations because I don't like Republicans, but I don't think they're doing it for the right reasons, obviously, since especially according to their theory, they stayed in that terrible place. But anyway, so he, of course, as is his wont, decided to make an to dress up an ideological argument in the form of a diagnosis, pragmatic, just, you know, calling strikes and balls argument. And he-
Technocratic argument. I love
technocratic,
that.
Technocratic, exactly. Technocratic argument, right. And he claimed that, you know, the Lincoln Project really helped deliver. They did great work in getting Biden into office. So basically, long story short, is that Daily Poster, another shout out to Daily Poster, founded by a dear friend of the show, actual friend of the show, and actual guest of the show, David Sirota. It turns out that Max Boot's thesis that the Lincoln Project helped out is wrong. He got some numbers wrong in an op-ed in the Washington Post. And the actual op-ed, of course, the headline was not changed. They changed some, they did what we call a stealth edit in the business, right?
Which or is when a you make, silent edit.
Or a silent edit, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You'd never know. But what's interesting is that Daily Poster did an analysis of the media ads that the Lincoln Project put out. And they spent, they raised, do you know how much, guess how much money they raised? Just give a
$100
guess.
Million. Dollars.
$77 million.
Okay.
As Daily Poster points out, the Lincoln Project's GOP operatives raised huge money from liberals by asserting that they would peel away Republican support from Trump. However, Washington Post reporters poured cold water on that idea, on the idea that Never Trump groups succeeded in doing that. And, despite pleas by Never Trump voices, the president secured a larger share of Republican voters nationally, 94% in 2020, than 4 years ago when he won 88% and third party candidates received more support. And a good friend of the show, Ben Tulchin, also backed that up. But the point is the headline, Never Trumpers played a critical role in beating him. The numbers prove it. That is still the headline, even though his numbers are off.
Okay, a couple things here.
Yeah.
First of all, and I have a thing coming out about this pretty soon, but the stealth edit has become a serious problem.
Yeah.
In journalism, and it takes like six different forms. All of them are really super sneaky, and you know, for some of us, we remember like the more obvious examples. Remember when they did that, the Bernie article, and then they went back and they changed it from like, he's really a good congressman to he kind of is average, yeah. And small ball. Yeah, it was around the edges, whatever it was. But it was obvious enough that but they didn't like.
You got caught. You caught them. You were among the people who caught them.
Yeah, although it wasn't me. Somebody tipped me off. But you know, that is only one form that it takes where they just don't tell you. Like a lot of times the first version of a story will come out and editor, they'll get feedback and they'll go in and they'll tweak something. Sometimes it's because some editor who's higher than the immediate editor,
right,
sees the story, doesn't like it. And then it's one of those shit rolls downhill things where they're telling the reporter's editor to make changes. And so that's when you will hear about it, because the reporter will quietly complain to somebody in those instances. But they're doing it in like all these other ways now that are really interesting. Like, and we saw this with a lot with the Russiagate stories, where they'll make a correction in the text, and then for like a day, there will be an editor's note at the bottom of the story that will say an original version of this story said X, Y, and Z, but we changed it to, you know, A, B, and C because of something, right? And then they will disappear the editor's note. So it gets them out of the ethical problem of not disclosing, you know?
But then it's just temporary.
It's just temporary.
Right? Like if you blink, you miss it.
Right. Or they'll put the disclosure somewhere else. Like then they might do like a separate story on like a new piece of news, and they'll say, yes, we know we reported this before, but we, you know, for whatever reason, we stand by our story, but you won't see the new information in the original story. So when you go to search for it,
right, it'll still come up the old version, the incorrect version. It is really stunning.
Yeah. So this is like it's like a serious problem because most people, like, you know, articles kind of live forever. They're not like, you know, you think that they're like permanent living documents like they were in newspapers, but they're not. They're like changeable. And I think what's happening is there's no standard about it. And people are just kind of winging it, which is really crazy.
But just to wrap the, what is it, thread the needle, or I should have said this earlier, but just to summarize what it was that Max Das Boot said, the headline was "Never Trumpers played a critical role in beating him. The numbers prove it." And then he said that the groups, you know, the Lincoln Project and the whatever other Republican group, former Republican or Republicans for Biden, quote, "shared with me preliminary data to show that their work actually played a critical role in Biden's victory. Their numbers are in line with publicly available exit polls showing that nationally 7% of 2016 Trump voters and 8% of Republican or Republican-leaning voters back Biden. Those figures are more than twice Biden's current popular vote margin." And then Daily Poster writes, "those numbers don't actually prove anything. 7% of 2016 Trump voters is equal to roughly 4.4 million votes. With some votes still outstanding, Biden is up by more than 5 million votes." And Emma Catherine DSA tweeted about Max's thing, "this is why math is in fact very important in education."
The point of the story is that the people who were most influential in helping Biden win were not like all these ordinary people. It was clearly the defecting neoconservatives, blah, 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 who have now joined forces with the Democrats, right?
Right. You're saying that that's their narrative, right?
That's their narrative,
yeah,
right?
Of course,
so what, you know, but the Biden presidency is going to be this ongoing, there's the tension that already exists between two different visions of what we're going to see going forward. I think it's already pretty clear that they see themselves as norms defenders, right? Like we're going to restore all these norms, some of which are good, right? They're going to get us back into international treaties that Trump backed out of and other craziness. But, you know, for the most part, what I think they think is the best part about this presidency is that it's going to bring all these beltway, you know, national security hacks and, you know, Atlantic Council and, you know, all these people that Max Boot and people of his ilk like, you know, they're going to be the new face of the, I guess, the Democratic Party. So
right, that way they can justify. I mean, we talked about this last week, right? But like, if you say that they're the reason that they won, then you can exactly kind of justify not listening to, for instance, Sunrise Movement.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, they wouldn't listen to him anyway.
Right. But now they get to pretend that there's exactly. They get to hide behind the technocracy, the technocratic right. argument instead of the ideological one.
All right. So for isn't that terrible? Dan, if we could see this headline. So there's like three things going on here. First, the headline is Kissinger warns Biden of U.S.-China catastrophe on scale of World War One. I think what he's saying is that there's going to be an interlocking, like a series of problems with alliances or something like that. That doesn't matter. The thing that's bad about this is that now that Biden is elected, we actually have to start listening to Henry Kissinger.
Right.
I've already seen headlines like Hillary Clinton warns that X, Y, and Z. So they're all going to come back. It's like, it's all like the entire like Herman Munster family.
That's good. I like that. Yeah.
Of, you know, sort of Clintonian war criminal types. He's back in the fold now. So we can go back to being confrontational with all these world powers.
Right. I just want to say my favorite part of Biden being elected is that I get to criticize him without anyone telling me I'm helping Trump get elected for selfish reasons. But do you think that...
Until Trump announces that he's going to run 2024.
Right. Well, or, you know, like we're going to... Matt Crisman predicted this, that from Chapa Trapas, that people are going to be like pushed into falling in line no matter what. Like before it was because, or else we'll let Trump win. Now it'll be like, oh, but come from the get-go, like give him a chance, or the Proud Boys, you know, something. It's always going to be something. So we should prepare for that.
Yeah, it's going to be Russia, the Proud Boys.
Norms,
anti-Semitism. We can talk a little bit about our guests. I mean, yeah. You know, they'll just keep coming up with stuff.
The biggest thing is gonna. I mean, look, we've already seen this. I almost want to thank them for being so overt about it. In fact, there's a very like overlooked and neglected piece of audio of Biden in the 70s saying that the reason he didn't support busing is because it's a rejection of Black pride.
Right. Yes.
Which is like amazing. And he really is a trailblazer in that.
Yeah,
field.
Right. He was a visionary.
He was like weaponizing. He was like pseudo woke before anyone else was pseudo woke. And he was weaponizing that.
Yeah. No. So I don't really have anything else to add here. It's except that my terrible this week isn't like, you know, a plague of rats or, you know, a sinkhole. But just the
it's
fact
almost,
that
it's almost as serious, but not quite as the rats.
Just the return of all these people to respectability is a little worrisome. So.
Do you think that they may be more hawkish than Trump?
So I mean, my theory about Trump was always and war was always that he had a probably some kind of on some level an instinct that. Politically, it wasn't a good move for him. Probably also, and this I think we saw with the very beginning of his presidency when he stopped having the daily briefings on intelligence, for which they, you know, they pilloried him for that. But I don't think he wanted to have generals in his office every morning.
Right. Yeah, I remember.
You know? Yeah. And so between probably having an instinct that he would screw it up, and also just not wanting to have to deal with the logistical hassle of it.
Yeah.
I always thought he was kind of like disinclined for war in a way that some politicians maybe, I mean, not for any good reason. I just think that that's what was the case with him. Like laziness.
Yes.
Maybe.
Laziness, opportunism, not wanting to spend money. I mean, this is, you know how Bill Maher has new rules? We have to have old rules, which is that like, here's one of the old rules. You can't say in response to what we're saying, oh, you think Trump likes peace? You think Trump is a peacenik? You think he's an anti-imperialist? No.
Right.
No. Sorry, I hate that response. Like whenever you try to discuss this, someone comes in to explain to you that Trump is not actually like an anti-war guy. It's like, right, we know that. We are not talking about his motivations.
I mean, the yeah, but Trump thing, like, yeah. And I think we saw this in the last couple of weeks, but by the end of his presidency, like, it made, like, every cell in my body squirm, you know, whenever people did that, because they did it so often. Like, we're not saying the guy's good. We're saying that, you know, politically or for whatever reason, that just his administration is disinclined to do X or Y. And, you know, but he's gone from the scene, but very quickly they're going to be returning the specter of Trump so we're in like a grace period now. So.
And isn't he trying to pull out of Afghanistan?
Well, a lot of the Republicans are saying that's what's going on, is that he's trying to, that some of the moves that he's making in the Pentagon are rather designed to declassify Russiagate stuff or to effect a withdrawal from Afghanistan, just to leave a big fat mess for, but we'll see. I of course have my doubts that would ever happen, that anybody could actually do that.
Yeah, and Tammy Duckworth doesn't want that to happen because she doesn't want the troops to come home in body bags. I don't know if there's like a booby-trapped exit from Afghanistan that would kill anyone coming back.
Oh, yeah. Why save their lives? Because that could kill them, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Makes
sense. Really a beat poet at the end of the day, Tammy Duckworth.
Does she type with a cigarette in her hand?
No, I just imagine, like, in that context, it kind of makes sense.
I see. Okay. We should do that. We should do a show where we have French cigarettes.
Yeah.
What do we have for Isn't That Weird?
So for Isn't That Weird, Dan, if you could click on that link front under my Isn't That Weird. It's funny, Matt, that you brought up rats because, let's just take a look at this. So this is something I saw on Twitter. Rex Chapman, I think, tweeted it.
I love this. Yeah, Rex Chapman, who is, another comeback basketball player.
Oh, right, of course. So that is, for people who don't watch the show, who are only listening, there is that famous image of a rat eating pizza, in a slice of pizza, or dragging a slice of pizza. So this is a human, we think, reenactment of it. And you see him dragging a huge slice of pizza, which is not real. How big would you describe that? I mean, I guess is the ratio between the human and the pizza the same as the ratio between the rat and the real rat and the real pizza?
It's like the size of a queen size mattress, I would say.
Yeah. Heck, they should make, why don't they make pizza
mattresses?
Beds? Yeah.
Pizza. Well, because your feet would both be in it.
Well, yeah, but you're thinking of it wrong. Your feet go at the crust.
It could be Sicilian.
Oh, yeah, Sicilian. That would be great. Yeah, I really love Sicilian. Or margarita or grandma, whichever one, same shape, but thin instead of Sicilian, which is thick, obviously.
Right, yeah, yeah. We're off track now.
We're off train track. So that's...
So what he liked about that, though, was that was dude going down the stairs not even paying attention to the rat.
Oh. Yeah, dude is going down the stairs, and he climbs over the railing. What is it? The banister?
Yeah, the banister, the railing, whatever.
Railing, whatever. He just casually.
He doesn't want to deal with the guy doing the funny rat bit because he's got to get it on a train, which is so New York. That
is that like some kind of PSA? Like, don't leave your scraps in the train, or is it just a fun, like, performance art?
It's just the dude in New York. Maybe it's a person in New York trying to get on the internet, you know.
Yeah, and he won. You're right. Aren't we suckers? Isn't that weird?
Yeah,
his tail is kind of scary looking.
Yeah, you know, my favorite thing about rats is the Latin name for rat, which is just Rattus Rattus.
Oh, that's good.
Is a really good name.
Very emphatic.
There should be a band called Rattus Rattus.
Yeah. Is there like a Rattus not as Rattus or something? Like,
I don't know. Yeah, like less Rattus Rattus or
minor Rattus minoris.
Right. So that was good. Man dragging pizza upstairs in New York. So those are our four food groups.
Yeah. We also probably should talk about some very sad news, which is that we lost. Someone's been fired.
Who?
Toobin.
Toobin got fired.
Yeah. Yeah, he was fired by the New Yorker.
I should hire him.
You know, yeah, you should hire him. And You know, you should. Well, first let's test him out on the show.
I'll just have him do his, like, you know, stand-ups from places. Jeff, I want you to cover the opening of a pizzeria on West 79th Street. Can you
78th and Broadway was the best, yeah.
Really good place, right? So just I'd like you to be there at 6:17 with your pants on, you know?
See, you know what's interesting is that there's a lot of talk about about malprivilege, and there's a piece at The Wrap by Sharon Waxman. It says the comeuppance of Jeffrey Toobin, but where's CNN? And the subheader is, this reeks of malprivilege. When your job is to weigh facts and render conclusions that shape public opinion, one's own judgment should matter. And then she writes, I've been trying to avoid the train wreck that is Jeffrey Toobin, but like any good crash, it keeps drawing me back in horrified fascination. Let's face it, any headline that combines the words The New Yorker and masturbation is hard to resist. And at the same time, the story promises such a cringe fest that I didn't really want to know the details. But you know what I'm going to say? Here's what I'm going to say. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
This reminds me. So a lot of people are like, oh, Toobin, why is he allowed to get away? Was he allowed to get away with this? It's because he was a man and we should make sure to send a message that that's not acceptable. But you know what that reminds me of? It reminds me of the same short-sighted, kind of draconian, misguided, misdirected sentiment that is, oh, why did this kid get off with a heavier sentence? You know, he has affluenza. Why are white kids allowed to not serve jail time for things that black kids are you know, overly incarcerated for? And that's true, of course. But the direction you want to go there isn't let's lock up more white kids. It's let's not lock up as many black kids. And my fear here is that this is the same tendency where we're not keeping our eyes on the prize. The point is we should let all people dabble in Zoom mistakes like that. We have to have clemency.
Zoom clemency?
Yeah, Zoom clemency. And again, I don't know why no one's talking about the significance of, like, why, it's like they just want to punish him because they think it's an example of malprivilege. Again, I think we should be pushing back in the other direction. I mean, I'm just saying maybe women should start doing this on Zoom calls. That would be the other way to handle this unjust injustice.
It would be interesting to see how that would be handled in the press.
How that would be dealt with
in the press.
Yeah.
To headline tomorrow, Katie Halper, men should just keep flogging it on Zoom.
Yeah. No, that's not fair. It's that so should women.
And
women need to start. That's the feminist solution to this.
Well, I think we've made our positions clear on this.
Yeah. Pro-Toobin.
Yeah.
Hard line for me.
All right. Just quickly, I think we're gonna try out something new.
Oh yeah.
On the show this week, because I think we're there's a muscle we're just not flexing enough, which is that we're not lending enough of our wisdom in terms of what Netflix or Amazon Prime Entertainment you should be watching. We want to chime in,
yes,
about all these things that everybody's talking about. But we want to stop short of actually watching the programs.
Yeah because so, our voices and our views are so, they're not dependent on that.
Right. Yeah. This is about voice. It's about posture. It's
centering,
about expression.
Centering.
Centering. Right.
Independent voices. Yeah.
Yeah. So we have something to contribute, whether we actually watch the shows or not.
That's not as important at all, yeah.
Right. So let's, Dan, if we could just see the first story by the Washington Post. So we're talking about the show The Crown.
Yeah.
And I have like 8 reasons why I'm not going to watch this show. But we don't have to get into this.
And I should add that I've seen a few episodes and I stopped watching. So I feel like even more empowered. Well, right, I'm less qualified than you because I've seen part of it. You're more qualified because you haven't seen any.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm really going out on a limb.
Yeah.
So this is like a new phenomenon in media where they're like fact checking stuff that's entertainment. Fact checking The Crown, what the man who broke into the Queen's bedroom really wanted.
I think we all know the answer.
Well, let's just answer this question first. Katie, do you feel that this episode was rendered accurately or not?
No, I don't.
And that's based on what?
Based on just a gut feeling.
A gut feeling.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to go the other direction and say that it was rendered accurately.
Right.
Do you think it was it a good episode?
I mean, it probably wasn't a good episode because I think it peaked at when Elizabeth's father died. I guess that was the King of England. Spoiler alert. It fell off then, and I'm just going to assume it didn't get back on, and there are no interesting characters except for him. There was a really gross scene where you saw him getting, like, a lung removed, I guess, because he had lung cancer. I had no idea. It looked like a slab of meat. But
yeah,
anyway.
Lungs are surprisingly meat-like when you actually see them.
So gross. I'm going to say that I thought it was not accurate. You know, and of course I'm talking about Michael Fagan, the 32-year-old bloke who in 1982 not once but twice broke into Buckingham Palace and roamed the halls, drinking wine, sitting on thrones and admiring paintings.
That sounds like fodder for an interesting dramatic series.
It does, yeah.
Yeah. But not interesting enough for us to watch it. Right. Dan, if we could see the next story. Here's one. Margaret Thatcher's relationship with Queen Elizabeth was more nuanced than the Crown portrays. Do you agree?
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
Yeah?
Yeah, because, I mean, I haven't seen this show, and I don't actually know anything about their relationship. But, I mean, I just feel like that makes sense because I just can't imagine it not being the case.
Right. Do we know who's playing that? It's Gillian Anderson.
Oh, she's a good actor.
What's her whole... Is she British? She does that other show that's based in Northern Ireland that's about a serial killer and takes too long to develop.
It's like, yeah, it's that really makes me... I can't watch that. I have a high threshold for violence and crime and stuff in my shows, but that's just way too... Yeah, no. And I find her character really arched in that show.
Yeah, I couldn't connect... And the
oh, you couldn't connect with the main character, serial rapist, serial killer.
Oh, definitely not. No. Surprisingly, because sometimes in these shows you do.
Yeah,
you're,
that's the whole point, right? Is that it's like an anti-hero, yeah.
Yeah, they want you to like
feel conflicted. Like,
you ever see Starship Troopers?
No, but I know it's very anti-fascist, right?
Well,
anti-war.
Yes, but the whole point of the movie is to get you cheering for the fascists.
Right, to show you how dangerous it is.
To show you how it happens, because they do a really great job of killing bugs. Yeah, I'm going to say that Gillian Anderson's representation of she playing Thatcher?
The Iron Lady, yeah.
It probably doesn't do justice to the more nuanced reality that was the relationship.
Right.
Between Queen Elizabeth and the actual Margaret Thatcher.
Well, now I'm going to have to shift positions and say, no, it did do justice.
It did.
Yeah.
It
always
it?
Does. It captured it. I mean, the one thing about the crown, that's so good about
the cross
it.
The cross is coming next year. That's with who's going to be
Jesus?
In the lead
is that
role?
About Jesus?
Yeah, that's going to be
Mel Gibson.
No, it's not going to be Mel Gibson. It's going to be the Rooney Mara.
Rooney Mara. Yeah,
Rooney Mara will play the lead role in the coming Netflix series, The Cross,
which is about what?
About Jesus.
She's going to play Jesus, or
yes.
She's going to play Mary. Oh, okay.
She's going to play Jesus.
Got it. Oh, because it's like a re-envisioned.
I don't know. I just
gender,
see it that way. Or it could be that, or it could be it could be Hulk Hogan. I don't know, but I'm seeing Rooney Mara, I guess.
I guess Hulk Hogan, you'd imagine he couldn't stay. I won't buy that he stays nailed into the cross.
would they have long enough nails?
No, I don't think so, right? He would just thrash through them.
That would completely change the whole face of history,
exactly,
right?
Yeah.
Because then our whole idea about Christianity isn't like, you should just deal with it because like, you know, if you accept your fate with grace, you can get into heaven. Then the message of Christianity should be just like struggle against the fucking nails, right?
Yeah.
That
fight
be,
back.
Fight back. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Dan, if we could see the third story.
Oh, I love this actress.
Who's the actress?
She's from Broadchurch.
Oh, right.
Name?
Yes. Yeah.
She's so great.
Olivia Colman.
Okay, so the Crown fact check, were the Queen's cousins hidden in an asylum? Were they?
They were in plain sight.
They were in plain sight. They were not hidden. I think we're agreed on this, that this was an inaccurate representation.
Everyone knew that they were there. They were beloved in the asylum.
Yeah.
They actually greeted, they were asylum greeters.
Yeah, and that story, I just briefly, this is something I gleaned from 1 second of seeing that story. I don't even know what the news source is, but Helena Bonham Carter plays Margaret. And I'm going to say she does it well.
She does well. And she's right? not hidden. I mean, she just owns it. She's a commanding presence.
Right.
She always is. Yeah. And it's called the breeder greeter. That's when you are inbred, a royal inbred person. And you are, but you're centered. You're allowed to be a greeter at the mental asylum.
Ah, that's what this is.
That's, yeah.
Okay.
You know, we've all heard of the breeder greeter.
Right. Right.
Throughout history.
Right. Yes, of course. That old saw. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, my only problem was that the breeder greeter thing is so, no, it was important to show it. We've all read about it.
Yeah.
And this is, so the other cool thing about this new segment is we are going to tell you about things that you may not have even heard about, but that are actually, you're going to want to mention at dinner parties.
Right. But we don't even know what we're talking about. So when you talk about
them.
It,
when... we are discovering things, you know, it's like, it's, what is it? It's, what's the big Descartes, the Cartesian thing?
I think they're for
yeah. So that's really, we're leaning into that direction.
So we don't think that, therefore we aren't.
No, wait. We think therefore we are. So we create, you know.
I see. Okay. All right.
So if a tree falls in a forest and nobody hears, it doesn't make a sound. Well, we're saying we're gonna say that
if,
it does.
If a tree falls on Netflix, did anybody rate it?
Yeah.
And review it.
Not only did we rate and review it, but we told you about the history of trees.
Right. Okay. So we're agreed right now that, you know, the show's promising. It's doing great. Everybody's talking about it.
Yeah.
But we're still not going to
watch it. How many seasons is it?
Too many. Two.
I mean, two. That's too many. That's three many. Three too many. I want negative. I mean, it's funny. It's like I'm conflicted because I've learned so much from not watching it.
Right.
But
it's four seasons, by the way.
Four seasons. Okay. Thanks, Dan.
Yeah. I know it all. Thanks for mansplaining, Dan.
We didn't know that, and
thanks
now
for
we do.
Thanks for dansplaining. Yeah.
Yeah. Feel free to go back to your mute button there.
Yeah.
Buddy.
Is four seasons an accurate amount of seasons for the show The Crown, though? Have they portrayed that well online?
No,
Google
I mean,
search?
No, that's the thing. You barely get the sense that it's four seasons. Having not watched the show, I'm confident. I feel confident saying that you have no idea it's four seasons.
So wait, if they're still in the Thatcher years in season four, this could fucking go on forever.
I mean, the sun never sets on the British Empire or shows about the British Empire. But I do want to recommend, again, I feel unqualified because I actually been watching it, but I do like The Queen's Gambit. And I saw Chicago 7. Great entertainment. Really weird political messaging.
Sounds good. Well, we can ask our next guest about The Crown or not, because that would probably offend
Yeah, him. The Crown or Chicago 7.
Yeah, but...
We'll say that that's why we're having him on.
We're about to interview one of the great rock stars of all time, which is amazing. So we're going to talk to Roger Waters. Obviously, great musician, tremendous legacy in rock music, and
very political.
Very political. A lot of really interesting political opinions that he doesn't get to talk about as much because everybody's always giving him a hard time about them. So we want to let him talk about some things and see what he has to say, and it should be really interesting.
That should be the subtitle of our interview segments. Talk about some things.
Talk about some
useful
things.
Idiots. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Cool. So we will. We're gonna talk to Roger Waters.
Hey, Matt.
How are you doing, Roger?
I'm doing
Thanks
well.
So much for doing
I
this.
I see you've got shit all over your walls.
I do, yes.
All I have
quite
is,
a lot.
If you look over my shoulder, you can see the elephant in the room.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
It's very important. Super
that's
important.
That's really good.
That is an excellent joke. I like
it
that.
It really is good, yeah.
Thank you so much for doing this.
Okay. Yeah, so
You're
excited.
Very welcome. What are we're talking about Julian, are we?
We can, yes. But in fact, that's a good place to start. You've been really outspoken about that. I actually saw you on the Tucker Carlson show talking about that.
First and last.
Yeah, I was going to say, but the irony there is, like, if you want to talk about the Assange case on television in America, that's pretty much the only place you can go.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
Right. So, first of all, can you speak to what your reaction has been to the way the American news media has covered that story or not covered it? It's been really strange in the last year, especially.
Well, I've been completely unamazed.
Exactly.
It's entirely what I would expect.
Right.
As we know, the mainstream media in the United States and in the rest of the American empire, which would include the UK, obviously, most of the EU, blah, blah, Australia, certainly, Canada, whatever. All the media in all of those places, they all carry something around in their back pocket, which they check. They go, can I talk about that? No. That's how it runs. And they're completely controlled by the ruling class, and that's all there is to it. So you just have to kind of get used to it. And stop writing editorials for the New York Times or the London Times or the Guardian.
You've paid kind of a pretty heavy price for talking about BDS. And also, I mean, you support, you wrote a letter of support for Corbyn.
Oh, yeah.
And it's been kind of amazing. Like this, the line of attack against progressive politicians like Corbyn, that they're anti-Semitic. I actually didn't see that coming because they didn't use it here against Sanders, but it was pretty effective, wasn't it? Or do you think it was?
Well, oh, what, against Corbyn?
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
This is a fight that's only just started.
Right.
I am in touch with a lot of activists in the United Kingdom, and we're going to fight back again. I am now involved in legal matters, where I'm using what little cash I have. Well, I actually have quite a lot of cash, which is why I use some of it for things like this, to defend members of Jewish Voice for Labour, okay? Who, and there are three of them who, there's one in particular whose name I can't remember, Melissa, somebody or other. I didn't know we were gonna be talking about this, so I haven't got my notes. I'm very bad at names. Who is being sued by John Ware, who is the guy who directed the disgusting Panorama hatchet piece on, quote, anti-Semitism in the Labour Party, which is a total put-up job, plays fast and loose with any real information, but they're trying to crucify left-wing members of the Labour Party who wouldn't stand for it. The great tragedy of Jeremy Corbyn, wonderful man as he is that he didn't stand up and tell them to fuck off at the Labour Party conference in 2019. And he didn't. He somehow thought that appeasement was going to work. He went all Chamberlain with Adolf Hitler. I have in my hand a piece of paper signed by the German Chancellor. But we all know the scene. Well, Jeremy, bless him, somehow I think he thought that it will be all right. And it wasn't. They killed him. Stone dead, and it's talk about foreign governments interfering with elections. The Israeli lobby totally destroyed any chance of there being a fair election in England in 2019, but they actually did it, and the evidence is all there. And there have been a number of documentaries made about it, called The Lobby by Al Jazeera. There's two of them. There's one about England and one about they're both kind of, it's so open and shut and there in your face all day, every day. But it's interesting that you say to me, the price I've paid, I haven't paid any price. What price have I paid? I haven't paid a price. I'm still working. I've got a tour, which we've rescheduled for next year. I'm working hard on that. When I go out, there's bums on seats everywhere. I make more than a decent living. And so far, and I'm touching wood furiously here, they haven't managed to shut me up.
Yeah. I mean, with the Corbyn aspect, it's interesting, Matt, you said that about Bernie. I mean, of course, Bernie being Jewish gets him the honor of, I get this too, not to compare myself to Bernie, but if you're Jewish and you're critical of Israel, you're called a self-loathing Jew. as opposed to an anti-Semite. So, but Corbyn didn't have that luxury. So he was full on, you know, just you know, savage.
Well, Bernie also, again, bless him, you know, kind of, you know, what's not to love about Bernie Sanders compared with all the others, at least. But he also is just, he's towing so many party lines.
Yeah.
He stood up behind Guaido in Venezuela when they attempted to destroy democracy in that country as well.
You mean he like stood up?
I couldn't believe it. I was going, what are you doing? This is insane. But there we are.
Yeah.
Luckily, that great experiment, Bolivarian revolution in Venezuela, has resisted all the attempts by the American Empire to destroy it and to destroy its people as well. Who are the first time in the last 400 years or since the Spanish got to Central and South America, have had a chance, just a chance, to have a fair crack at the whip or in a fair slice of cake. And they're getting it as well. Will it survive? Who knows?
It actually goes to another question I wanted to ask you, because I've read before where you've talked about that you pay taxes in the United States. Yeah. Most of your taxes go to the Pentagon.
Yeah.
And that issue is just never part of our electoral discussion. We never talk about whether we should spend less or more, or whether we should be in other countries less, or doing, is that frustrating? You know, as somebody who lives here, or like,
Of course. Enormously frustrating. My good friend in Melbourne, Australia, Caitlin Johnson, whose blog you must know, says almost nothing else. She says more or less the same thing day after day after day after day. Is there any chance of the American public waking up to the huge lie that it has been told, that it is somehow vulnerable to attack from outside, and in consequence needs to line the pockets of the very rich by giving anybody's tax dollars to Raytheon and all the other armaments companies, which gets funneled straight into the pockets of the trillionaires. That's what war is for. And they don't, the American people can't seem to get their minds around it, even though it's been quite obvious since Korea.
How would you say it compares the situation in the United States and in England in terms of the anti-war movement or kind of an awareness of what the government is doing?
You know, what is interesting is that the cabal, United States, UK, France, Belgium, Germany, whoever, the whole Australia, Canada, you always have to include them because they're extremely culpable in all of this, have such a tight grip on policy that what the man in the street says, as demonstrated on February the 14th, or whichever day it was, 2003, there can be 30 million of us in the streets all over the world explaining to these fuckers that what they're doing is criminal and insane and morally corrupt and completely wrong and can do nothing but incalculable harm for years and years and years to come. And G.W. Bush and Tony Blair and all the others went, "You, we don't care. We don't care what you think. We couldn't give two ticks for what you think." Turns out you were right. You were completely right. All those millions and millions of people in the street. And what a sight. Not that I was there in any of the cities. I wasn't. I was probably on the road, you know, doing something useful.
Right.
But it happened. And it's there as an example for everyone to see. They were right, you arseholes. You were wrong. The many got it completely right. You, the very few rich bastards who tell everybody what to do, got it completely wrong. And they will sit and look at me and say, "No, we didn't. We made fortunes. We got it exactly right. We're making fortunes now. We don't give a shit about the pandemic or a few people dying in front. Oh, lots. Kill them all. So long as we're lining our pockets. That's all we care about." And it is. The weird thing is that they somehow keep this because they're so good at propaganda, they keep it from the quote voters. As we all know, America is not actually a democracy. The electoral system, apart from anything else, makes certain of that. And in the last few years anyway, Citizens United was the final nail in the coffin. And now there's a 6-3 majority in the Supreme Court. You're going to see a lot more of that, of them deciding what the law is and telling everybody else. Oh, well, send it to the Supreme Court. They're bloody good at deciding what's right and what's wrong. No, they're not. They're terrible at it. So who knows whether America, the United States of America, might eventually, or the people might eventually cotton on to the truth that the country is not being organized for their benefit. They have no health service. They have virtually no welfare. They live in poverty. Most of them are in penury. People can work at full-time jobs, sometimes two full-time jobs, and still be living out of the trunk of an old car that they can't afford to get fixed. It's incredible. In the richest country in the world, I'm starting to rant.
You know, I thought one of the things that was the Bush years was interesting is that they figured out they didn't have to listen or worry about protesters anymore. They had these huge protests against the Iraq war and they just kind of ignored them. Yep. There were artists who were organized. I mean, back in the 60s and 70s when Pink Floyd was coming up, people were afraid of what artists thought, right? Like they led anti-war movements. They were major forces in culture. Is that still true now? Like, or like the leaders?
I hope not. I hope that this new Black Lives Matter, post-Ferguson, post-George Floyd, or currently with George Floyd, that movement, that I hope that has struck enough of a chord that it won't go away. I realized halfway through this, and it's not halfway through, we're just at the beginning of this set of protests, that one shouldn't try and be nonviolent about this. They're not. Why, if you're fighting a monster that is the most violent thing that certainly that any of us have ever experienced, the United States government and the United States policing of the towns that we live in, they are incredibly violent. You know, and we know that this is the most violent country in the world, not just because there are more guns than there are people, which is pretty weird, but because they get used on people. And so the rate of deaths from the police in the United States is, I think it's like 4 or 5 times the number per million or per 10 million or however they gauge it as the next quote civilized country. It's extraordinary. And yet people go, you know, you see these good old boys driving up and down. I'm out in the Hamptons, I admit it. Okay, I admit it.
This is a safe space. It's okay.
And, you know, you see the good old boys in their pickup trucks covered in Trump 2020 flags. Thank goodness that didn't come to fruition. You know, and thin blue line flags and Confederate flags or whatever, honking their horns. Miles and miles and miles of them. So if there's one thing that Trump did, apart from be a buffoon and make everybody, you know, point and laugh, he made it acceptable to be a racist, supremacist, good old boy in a pickup truck, which shows us that it never went away. And that all the signing of legislation with LBJ at the end of the Vietnam War and whatever, somehow never actually crept into what this country is. So I was reading Mark Lamont Hill's new book the other day, We Still Here, and it's a really good book. I would recommend it to anybody who hasn't looked at it, because he is meticulous in describing the situation from his perspective, which is different, certainly, than mine, because he's black and I'm white. And it's different. It's hard for us to quite comprehend the nature of what happens in this country that we live in. Anyway.
And he's great at connecting that to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict.
Obviously, he's been very involved in that battle as well. But you will find that anybody who actually cares about justice cares about justice for everybody.
Yeah,
they really do. So, I've just got involved in my backyard with the Shinnecock Nation.
Oh yeah, I saw
that. We are just beginning, or they are just beginning. I'm just helping in every way that I can to engage New York State in a lawsuit that New York State has lost. Okay, so New York State sued the Shinnecock Nation to get them to tear down a monument. Well, they call it a monument. Everybody else would call it an advertising LED on the side of 27. The state sued these people for putting up an advertising hoarding on their land, on their reservation, that's protected by federal regulations. And the Shinnecock for the last 10 years have been recognized federally as a people and a sovereign people. So they go to court in Albany. I'm assuming this, but I'm pretty sure I'm right. And the judge rules for the Shinnecocks. No, you can't make them take it down. No, you can't stop them building more if they want to. No, you can't do that, and you can't do that. So what do they do? What are they doing? They're going to appeal it, and then they'll appeal it again and again. What they're going to try and do is starve them out. It's exactly the same tactics. Another court case I'm involved with is representing people in Ecuador against Chevron Corporation. Oh, yeah. This has been going on for 20 years. And Chevron at the beginning said, we're not paying a penny. When they lost the case, they lost it. They owe $9.5 billion to 30,000 Ecuadorian rainforest dwellers. They won't give them a single cent. They just said no. And they've done everything that they can. And at the beginning, they said, we will fight this case till hell freezes over. And when that happens, we will fight it on the ice. Give me another. I'm pretty tough hombre. Well,
that's what they said?
That's what Chevron said. Chevron, and I've said this to you often, I'm just an old bass player, but I'll be there on the ice. I'll be there. I'll fight you underwater when the ice is melted. You know, we're not going away. They've got our lead human rights lawyer in this. He's been under house arrest in New York. He's called Stephen Donziger for 500 days with an ankle bracelet. Can't go anywhere or doing. You know what? For a misdemeanor, for a contempt charge.
Like a contempt of court charge?
Contempt of court charge, yeah.
Wow. So your counsel's been in an ankle bracelet for over a year because of a wild.
You know what for? Do you know what his crime is? They tried to get him to turn over his laptop and his cell phone that he's used all the way through his advocacy for the Ecuadorian rainforest people to Chevron. And he went, I can't do that. That breaks client privilege. That's against the law. Contempt of court. Take the prisoner down. I mean, can you believe it? Luckily, this is starting to dribble out into the legal community. And there are now some very hard and heavy hitting and extremely well-respected lawyers, like Marty Garbus is one of them, but there are many of them. And they've now insisted on forming a committee to oversee the legal proceedings that are trying to send Stephen Donziger to jail for trying to stand up for human rights. But this is the country we're living in. That's why we have to be on the streets or wherever we can to fight back. We have to stand up and fight back and encourage one another across any barriers that there might be between progressive people. We have to ignore all of that and just stand together and help each other, because that's what community is, you know.
Yeah, how much are you worried about things like internet censorship, suppressing news about whether it's a case about Chevron or Israel-Palestine news. I mean, you've talked international
youth and students for social equality.
Exactly. That's right. There was a picture of me with a thing over my mouth with Twitter written on it. I'm hugely worried about it. These appalling monopolies. And they have secret meetings in the Pentagon. And they're totally controlled by the government, whoever it is. It doesn't matter, because whether it's Joe Biden or Donald Trump, they are following the same set of rules, and they have the same basic principles. They are going to maintain the grip of an extremely wealthy ruling class on this country and go on milking it for as long as they can, which, unless we, the people, stand up and say no, will be until it's all gone, because they're destroying it faster than it's possible for any of us to imagine. They're destroying the whole earth. And we all know that. You know it. You know, we're sitting, we all know that. Everybody knows it. We've been being told it by wise people for at least the last 50 years. But they go, psh, we're not bothered about that. Let's just keep making money. All of them.
This group that was shut down, they're, of course, associated with the world, the World Socialist website, and that you're always covering there, the censorship that happens to them, that sometimes the left gets a little confused, I think, and thinks that the way you shut down, like, right-wingers or racists is through content moderation, and as we try to point out on the show, that will wind up targeting socialists and Palestinians. The most misguided.
Absolutely. So I, on a piece of paper over there, I've got something that was an alternative to my thing with Twitter on it, which was said, liberate the internet, deconstruct Google, Facebook and Twitter. They're deeply, deeply dangerous monopolies. And they are becoming hugely more and more and more powerful. And this is, I mean, Facebook's probably the most powerful engine on earth. And it's run by some prick who got his start by grading co-eds in a high school. That's where he's at. I mean, it's unbelievable that he should have any influence on it, on any of that. And I don't know how it happened. I'm flabbergasted by it. But then I never had anything to do with any of them until a few years ago when I decided to go back on the road again. Oh, you've got to have a website. Why? Oh, because that's how people communicate with you. That's how people will know you're going on the road.
Right.
Oh, I thought you did it with radio. No, you do it like that. Oh, really? And so I started a website. I've got it now, rogerwaters.com. It's cool. And it was like, for the first 6 months, it had like 2,000 people now, and now it's, I don't know, 2.6 million or something. So it's slowly become a large number of people, and it's sort of in the sights of the Israeli lobby trolls and other trolls, and right white supremacist trolls as well. But is it dangerous? Yeah, it is. I sometimes have to ask myself, should you really be using Facebook at all? And it's always the same thing. You think, well, a one-man boycott is not going to if I could persuade the 300 million people who use Facebook, or however many it is, to all stop using it, I would. I absolutely would.
Was the wall, I always thought it was full of all this dystopian imagery and language and metaphor. I mean, do you think in this kind of like the tech world where we have all this global infrastructure that a lot of them, I don't know, you tell me, because I think I got some of it wrong in terms of what that album was about, but it always felt to me that it was a story about a future dystopia that could be coming. Is it more relevant today than it was then? What's the message?
If you think about it, it was 1979. You were probably about three.
I was nine.
You see?
But I love the album. I mean, I grew up listening to you.
Take this boy out of here.
I wasn't born.
Right. It would take her away as well. Yeah. No, I mean, it's very interesting that some of the imagery from the wall is the only thing that the Anti-Defamation League or any of the rest of them have tried to pin on me and have sort of vaguely succeeded. And that is the Star of David on the pig that somebody filmed at a wall show outdoors in Belgium in 2011 or something like that. Or whatever. But I explain obviously that pig came out in the part of the show where I, because of all the difficult things from my childhood and so on, have turned into a fascist demagogue. Mm-hmm. And I play that on stage in a black leather coat with an armband, which is crossed hammers, which might just as well be a swastika. It's quite obvious what I'm talking about, fascism. And the pig was part of that bit of the show. It floated over the audience. And it was malevolent. And it was covered in symbols. The Star of David was only one of them. There was also a crucifix, a McDonald's sign, dollar signs, obviously. I can't remember now, but there were about 20 different things. They, of course, you know, zeroed in on this. Anyway, I think at the time, I eventually thought, this is more trouble than it's worth, and removed it. It's not central. This show isn't about Israel. This show isn't about Zionism. This show is about extremism. Is this show partly about fascism? Yeah, it is. Is Israel an apartheid country? Yeah, it is. Is it bordering on fascist? Yeah, it is. But is it worth all of this? No, it's not. You know, I still, in the movie that I made from the thing, there was still, I think there were Stars of David falling out of bombers. So to answer your question, is it, nodding at Orwell and Huxley, looking forward to a dystopia that hasn't happened yet? Yeah, it is. But it's also looking back to Weimar Germany. It's looking back to 1933. It's looking back to the democratic election of the Führer, which, let's not forget, was part of the very first few pieces of that jigsaw puzzle. And we know where that ended up. Mm. So the wall covers myriad issues, and a lot of them are just personal, sort of 29-year-old man trying to transcend his frightened, scary childhood.
And to right, grow the up problems you had in school and that sort of thing.
Yeah, exactly. Which is something that we all have to do. Not all of us are lucky enough to have the luxury of being able to write pop songs about it. Mm. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, interestingly enough, the last record I made, Is This the Life We Really Want, is in many ways more direct. And I'm working on bits of songs from that. In fact, the title track from that, I've been working on the visuals of it for the new show just this last week.
Oh, wow. When are you going out on tour?
Well, that's a bit of a secret, the actual date, but it's sometime next fall, next autumn. Oh, great. Tour is called This Is Not a Drill. It's like the last few tours I've done. It will be thematic, conceptual, blah, 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 blah. But it will have old Pink Floyd songs in it. When I say old Pink Floyd songs, I mean my songs from when I was in Pink Floyd. So, because there's often some confusion about all of that. But luckily now, there are whole new generations growing up who've never heard of Pink Floyd, which is a very good thing.
Who are being reintroduced to your music. That's got to be cool. Right?
Well, they are. Yeah, it is cool. It is cool. Yeah. I love the fact that when I was on the road with Us and Them up until a couple of years ago, the demographics of the audience were quite extraordinary. They had an average age of 24 or something. They were nearly all young people. Then a few of my generation, and then a lot of my children's generation, but mainly young people who got it, copped it, and got, I want to go and see what that's all about. I've heard about it. I've heard about it. Now I want to go and see, which is cool. You know, what is going to happen? Isn't it fascinating and disgusting that we sort of don't know. The picture may become somewhat clearer now Trump's gone, because the fact that U.S. policy was being dictated by that skinny prick Kushner,
and, yeah. Yeah.
And the awful daughter, and they were swanning around on U.S. One or whatever, making foreign policy for Palestinians. I mean, it's disgusting. It's a huge joke, but it's a really, really disgusting joke. Will Joe Biden, is Joe Biden, who stands there and says, I'm the biggest, you know, supporter that Israel has ever had, you know, mean that there's any, will he move the embassy back to Tel Aviv? Yeah. Will he stop giving them $10 billion, bucks a year, or $3 billion it is, $3 billion a year in military aid? Probably not. He'd probably give them more just to show what a good chap he is. But I don't think the world will stand for it. They won't stand for it. And if it becomes a single state, the world will not stand for it being declared, very pleased with itself, patting itself on the back, apartheid state with no freedom, no sense of freedom, unless you're Jewish. But not for anybody else, and not for any of the indigenous people. They've tried to pretend that the indigenous people didn't exist. Golda Meir was that, you know, back in the 50s and 60s, this was their angle. There aren't any people here. Nobody lived here. Oh, really? Tell that to the 800,000 who left in 1948 and to the 2 or 3 million who are still there.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's the, one of their biggest historians, Benny Morris. Who was critical of, he was one of the new Zionist historians, and then he kind of flipped positions and wants Israel to invade, you know, to drop bombs on Iran. But he wrote this book, 1948, which like documents ethnic cleansing, what he called ethnic cleansing. And now he's all gung-ho for Israel. And they're like, what, how can you say that when you're the one who documented ethnic cleansing? He's like, it was ethnic cleansing. And if we'd done more, it wouldn't be a problem today. Which is just like
great,
so
great accent, by the way.
Thank you. Thank you.
Couldn't get away with that.
It's one of the perks.
Cutting my balls off if I did that.
Yeah. Double perks for me, no balls and happen to be Jewish. So double bonus, yeah. But it's just funny because that's, you know, here in the United States, I think it's people are much more successful at pretending that there were no people there. But there, it's kind of like the issue is just like, oh, they were there, but you know, they didn't belong there, or they all wanted to go, or you know, it's interesting how they have to try to struggle with the reconciling history and you know, like facts on the ground with ideology.
Well, you know, that battle is true all over the world. I am now part of it locally here, in Southampton, New York. Southampton, New York, guys. Okay, there is a war about to start with New York State judiciary because they will not accept the fact that they lost their court case to try and get the Shinnecock Nation to be quiet, shut up, and do their bidding and do as they're told. These are a proud and wonderful people, and they are sovereign on their land, and they cannot be told what to do. And more than that, the world, maybe not the East End of Long Island, but the world is waking up to the enormous emotional, mental health, even chaos in our societies because of the way the English, the French, the Germans, the Dutch, the Belgians, and all the other settler colonial nations treated all the indigenous people wherever they went anywhere in the world. And just slaughtered them, as many as they could, told the rest to be quiet or we'll slaughter you too. And it's only just in the very last few years that some of us white settler colonialists are beginning to wake up and go, wow, I can't believe we did that. But we did, and it was disgusting. And we're still doing it. It's happening all over the world. That's what the money that the Pentagon spends is used for. It's to do that to brown people all over the world. That is what it's for. It's to steal their lithium, their oil, anything mineral under the ground, anything, or to steal their labor anywhere there's a sweatshop. That's what it's for. That's what it's for. The American empire is to steal land and resources from brown people who don't live here, and to keep brown people who might like to live here out, separate them from their children and keep them in effing cages at the border. So you just, you know, you can say, I don't care, I'm a good old boy. Or you can go, you know what, that doesn't make me feel good. I don't feel good about that. In fact, I feel terrible about it. You see what it's doing. It's just heartbreaking. Sorry.
No, it's okay. But the last question that I had was sort of related to that. So when Trump is president, Trump looks like all those things,
yeah.
Right? Like he looks like a pig. Yeah. He is personally disgusting. He says terrible things. And he created for a lot of people a kind of political awareness that maybe they didn't have before because they were motivated to get rid of him. But how worried are you that maybe now that he's gone, that people aren't going to pay attention to the awful things that happen kind of beneath the surface? Now that there's no longer this horrific figure in public.
And for instance, just to add to that, Michelle Flourney, who's his likely pick for the Pentagon, she herself said when there was consideration of when Israel was proposing unilateral annexation of the West Bank, she said, I would hate to see some in Congress decided they are going to hold hostage our security assistance to Israel as a way of protesting their policies in the West Bank. So that's an example of the kind of Biden, you know, the kind of people we'll see in the Biden administration. They're not going to be born again Christians, Zionists, but they're fine with supporting Israel.
Yeah, well, it's like, what was the woman's name who they put in charge of the CIA who used to be
a
concentration camp guard in a black site in bloody Thailand or somewhere?
Haspel.
What was her name, Matt?
Gina Haspel.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
When you saw all that going on, you're going, oh my God, what? How is that not hard to believe? Of course they are. Just like this woman. Yeah, of course they're going to put an absolute dyed-in-the-wool murdering swine in that job because that's who you need. Nobody who wasn't would do the job.
Yeah.
You know, Noam Chomsky said something interesting about Davos a few months ago, and it stuck with me. He said they asked them all at the most recent Davos to list the 19 most important things, you know, blah, 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 blah. And climate change wasn't in the top 19 for any single one of the main executives at Davos. So you can have a chuckle about that and go. And I can't even remember what was the most important thing. But what he did say was that he said, whoever is the CEO of Exxon now, you know, or who was the CEO of Philip Morris during the tobacco things and all of that, they know the science. Because they did it. Exxon actually did a lot of the science, but it was inconvenient at the end of the day. So they all gather in Davos and all together they go, I know what to do. Let's destroy the world. And they all pat each other on the back and say, bloody good idea. And then they do it. But if you take one of them to one side and go, do you really want it? Don't you have children or grandchildren or anything? Why do you want to destroy the world? They go, and then you realize that they want to destroy the world because they're the CEO of Exxon and they get $10 million a year for being that, plus their bonuses and this and that and the other. And if they didn't destroy the world, Exxon would find somebody else to do it and they wouldn't have a job.
Right.
So they're totally ruled by the idea that A, they have power and a corporate jet and earn a lot of money. No, they're totally ruled by that. And the fact that they have children and grandchildren and the other people, obviously they don't empathize with others at all. They cannot have a shred of empathy to do it. But also they don't care about their own kids or their own grandchildren. They go, fuck it, we'll destroy the world. We have to make the money. It's weird. And he's right. Davos, you know, Davos, are you serious? Why is that helpful to anybody? That's all them. It's a gathering of them with a few U2 blokes thrown in on the side. The agent fucking, what's his name? As well. But it's not for us. It's not for the people. It's not for any... it's not for any proper reason. It doesn't do any good to anybody. I don't think, anyway.
Sorry, last question. I know I already said the last question. But I saw an interesting answer you gave once. Somebody asked you, like, can music be like a bridge that can help be an equalizer politically? Or, I forget what the question was. The person was clearly expecting you to say yes, and you said no. And basically you said, I don't believe music, you know, music can be an equalizer or affect politics in the way that the person was saying. But you did say that the music can help you discover empathy, or that it can help people do that. When you look back at your career and the music you're making now, what are you most proud of? What do you think music does for people? Like, what's the best thing about it?
Well, that's a very, you know, it's a broad question, and so there's a million answers, I think, to that question, because it only works specifically. If you were to say to me, what do you think about this particular song and what it might have done? Because immediately when I think about music, it's so broad. Because if you, even talking about a song, you might be talking about the melody or the arrangement or the structure or the production of a record. Or you might be talking about the ideas that are expressed in the lyrics, whether it's poetic, whether it means any, or political, or whether it stirs you in some way. It doesn't. I'm reminded of a poem that I wrote, I sent to Cormac McCarthy, the great American novelist. When I read All the Pretty Horses for the first time, when I'd finished it, I was so stunned by that book, by the writing, but also content, everything about it. You know. I wrote this. I sent it to him. He never replied, but I sent it. There is a magic in some books that sucks a man into connections with the spirits hard to touch, that join him to his kind. A man will eke the reading out, guarded like a canteen in the desert heat. But sometimes needs must drink, and then the final drop falls sweet, the last page turns the end. Well, that shows that I have an attachment to what literature can do for me under certain circumstances. That is also true of songs. So when I listen to Ray Charles singing Georgia on My Mind when I'm 15 years old, drinking a cup of tea at 2 o'clock in the morning in Cherry Hint Road in Cambridge, and like that feeling that we know of being moved by something, and in that case, a piece of music. I remember saying, that 15-year-old said to himself, if I could ever write anything that moved anybody, a millionth as much as this means me now, I would consider my work done. Not that I was even thinking then that I might become a songwriter someday. But so, yeah, of course, it's hugely important. And there are those transcendental moments. And it doesn't have to be that. It can be the adagio from Mahler's Fourth Symphony. Every time you hear that, you go, yeah, it still gets me. I used to play that before gigs, Mahler's Fourth Symphony, because it's like, and so thank God for Puccini and Mahler and, you know, the Romantics, which is where my great loves lie, but also for John Prine, who I miss desperately, but for the humanity of his work, it's the humanity of his work, you know, the laying out of the great human being that he is to share that with us, not just to illuminate our lives, but to help us get through tomorrow as well, to keep fighting.
One, just to clarify, I'm sorry if I didn't make it clear, but before when Matt, you asked about Trump and how we're going to survive post-Trump, or how we're going to be able to be as vigilant, right? Because I brought up Michelle Forney because, you know, she's an example of basically the same bad policies, but a little bit, but without the as inflammatory rhetoric, which is how I see Biden, like writ large. So I'm wondering if you have any ideas about how we can make sure to not like you know, just all go out and have brunch or go back to quote unquote normal when we have Biden in office. And then a question, I had a question about your father. And, you know, it's so interesting that he was a pacifist, right? And then he had a change of heart and fought in the war and was killed. How has that shaped, I mean, this is a huge question, but how has that shaped your view of nonviolence and violence? And has that view of that changed over time?
No, I don't think so. The fact, his story, and the fact that I know it, because it was told to me by my mother, obviously been hugely influential and probably quite difficult as well, looking back on it, because the act of a Christian, devout Christian, conscientious objector who goes through the extreme bravery of standing in front of the conscription board and saying, I can't kill people, and then driving an ambulance, and then changing his mind because he's become a communist and going back and saying, change my mind, and being, you know, conscripted and then officer training and then bang, dead. It's so heroic that it's a hard thing for a child to grow up with. There's some great stuff about this in Blood Meridian, which is another of Cormac McCarthy's great novels. Fantastic bit about this, but I won't go into that or we'll be here all day. What was the other part? So there's that. I've been working on Is This the Life, which is a song of mine. And there's lines in it that I've been working on for the last couple of weeks on visuals for them. And the very end of the thing goes, every time the curtain falls on some forgotten foreign life, it is because we all stood by silent and indifferent. It's normal.
Wow.
Yeah. So that is an appropriate piece of my writing on a record that I made in 2015. So it's already 5 years old. Things drift into the past very, very quickly and easily. And I'm going to tell my mum's story before we finish, because having spoken about my dad, when I was 13, I think, my mum one day, she said to me, we were talking about something that I was having a problem figuring out. And she said, Roger, as you grow up and through your life, you're often going to come across things where you have to make decisions about things and which may be complex, political things and other things, emotional, all kinds of different things. And when you do, and you find yourself wrestling with something, if you'll take my advice, you will look at it from all sides, listen to all possible opinions on it, do as much research as you can until you're really au fait with the subject, really feel you've got a grasp of it. After that, your work is done. All the hard work is done. The next bit is easy. You just do the right thing.
Wow.
Thanks, Mum! I mean, I'm joking. She's been dead for 10 years, my mum, but what an amazing gift to give an adolescent, because you can't get rid of it. I lived the rest of my life and have done, probably since that moment, though it only really sunk in maybe 20 years later after that, of what is the right, you know, because there's always a right thing, always. How do you figure it out? That's a trick.
It's great stuff. But
you know, if we can get more of us to do the right thing, then we're home free. We'll start looking after one another. We'll begin to have something that might be called a community, because that's what community is. It's looking after the most vulnerable of us, really properly looking after them. And for that, you need to stop spending all my tax dollars on nuclear weapons.
We'll try to get that changed.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thanks, all right. And keep practicing the drums.
Yeah. I will. I'm terrible. But they're fun. So that's the important thing. Thank you so much. It's been such an honor.
Yes, thank you so much. But this is great.
I love this blog thing, that you, if it's called a blog, that you do webinars stuff and many others that I watch because I follow you, you know, and Aaron Mate and my friends at Grey Zone and blah, 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 and all of those. But because you are the future of where, how do we get the grounding that we need to decide to do the right thing? You. That's why what you do is so valuable.
Wow. Oh, don't tell anyone.
You ain't going to get it from Fox News or CNN.
Probably not. No. Excellent. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you
on.
So much. This
appreciate
is so
it.
Great.
Good, and sure. Good luck with going on tour.
Again. Yes.
All right. Absolutely.
Yes, definitely.
All right. Take care now.
Cheers, guys.
That was amazing.
It was super interesting.
What's so cool about him is he really takes, you know, there's so many celebrities that, like, okay, music aside, there's so many celebrities who join these kind of milquetoast causes or champions that general, like, you know, loves Trump's hate, whatever. But he's just like in there with all the bravest takes positions. And like all over Israel, you know, Venezuela, like he's up on everything. Like,
so I grew up listening to his records and he's clearly got, he's got a part of his personality clearly that's like very sentimental and poetic. If you listen to songs like Wish You Were Here or Shine On You, Crazy Diamond, whatever. But then there's other stuff that's just like angry, and it's not like performative angry. It's like angry.
Yeah.
And it clearly comes from a real place, and that's that you can tell, you know, that talking to him, I never talked to him before, that it's not put on, it's not an act.
Yeah.
So really, really interesting. Very cool stuff. I'm gonna go watch the Bob Geldof version of The Wall now.
Yeah.
But anyway, great stuff. We'll get together again next week and we'll review more shows that we didn't watch.
Yeah, that's hopefully. One of the things. Yeah. And everyone should follow him on Twitter at Roger Waters. Just Roger Waters is his name and his Twitter handle and his website, rogerwaters.com. But seriously, it's like a great action alert. You'll see all these great causes that he's talking about.
All right, cool. Thanks for tuning in and listening, and rate and review us. Do not patronize the evil others. And
we're otherizing Pod Save America, and that's fine.
Yeah. And thanks again. We'll see you next week.
Great.